يس. بسم الله، الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Welcome to weekly lesson from the 40 Nawawis and the addition of Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali to overall 50 hadith. And tonight hadith number 19. It's very important for the young boys to know how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was looking after for the boys, for the new generation, and he always encouraged them and advised them. In this hadith, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma was nearly 7 or 8 years old, approximate. And then in this hadith, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam give him a nasiha, or he teach him a lesson. طيب نقرا الحديث maybe a little bit long but we finish inshallah. عن ابي العباس عبد الله بن عباس. ابي العباس is a kunya of عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال: كنت خلف رسول الله أو كنت خلف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يوما فقال: يا غلام إني أعلمك كلمات، احفظ الله يحفظك، احفظ الله تجده تجاهك، إذا سألت فاسأل الله، وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله، واعلم أن الأمة لو اجتمعت على أن ينفعوك بشيء لم ينفعوك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله لك، وإن اجتمعوا على أن يضروك بشيء لم يضروك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله عليك، رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف. رواه الترمذي. وقال: حديث حسن صحيح. وفي رواية غير الترمذي: احفظ الله تجده أمامك، تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة، واعلم أن ما أخطأك لم يكن ليصيبك، وما أصابك لم يكن ليخطئك، واعلم أن النصر مع الصبر، وأن الفرج مع الكرب، وأن مع العسر يسرا. طيب، this hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas is a cousin of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And also his auntie Maymuna was the أم المؤمنين or the wife of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Abdullah ibn Abbas ترجمان الأمة. He Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did a dua for him to learn the ta'wil or the tafsir. So he one of the mufassirin from the sahaba. And Abdullah ibn Abbas, Allah granted him the knowledge because of the da'wah in Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith start his hadith by saying ya ghulam. Ghulam means a young boy or a young man, which not exceed maybe 11, 12 years. Fata, if you say fata, you know what fata is, above 12, but still not mature. So we have fata, we have ghulam. طيب, يا غلام. And this is the way when you start your lesson or your nasiha or your talk to try to pay attention of the audience. يا غلام. By this is for you, so you have to be focused. Means when I tell someone ya Ahmed, ya Muhammad, that means that I need you to listen. طيب, غلام is a young boy, as we explain. And before we start translation and explanation of the hadith, there is some sahaba, a young sahaba was in the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have Al-Hasan, Al-Husayn, عبد الله بن الزبير. Also we have عمر بن أبي سلمة. We have also عمير, the brother of أنس. We have محمود بن الربيع. We have عبد الله بن عمر. All these Sahaba was young. يعني maybe if you الحسن born on 3 هجرة and الحسين 4 هجرة and عبد الله بن عمر in غزوة أحد was about 14 years old. So this is young boys. محمود بن الربيع was 5 years old when Prophet Muhammad sallam يعني around when he died about maybe 7 years old. So and look to how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam treats the boys or treats the young boy. For example, Amr or Umar ibn Abi Salama was sitting with him and eating from one dish, both of them eating from one dish, one plate. And Umar ibn Abi Salama, as you know, his mother is Umm Salama. Who's Umm Salama? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wife. And he was a Rabib. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a stepfather of him. But he noticed him when he started to eat. He ate from the side of Prophet, not from the front side. And his hand is moving all the way to a plate. And he ate with his left hand. And he didn't say Bismillah. So he started to say Ya Ghulam, also Ya Ghulam, Sammillah, say Bismillah. وَكُلْ بِيَمِينِكَ Eat with your right hand. وَكُلْ مِمَّا يَلِيكَ From the front of you. This is the way of ta'deeb, of adab. This, who's that? عمر عمر بن أبي سلمة. طيب, who's else? محمود بن الربيع. محمود بن الربيع said in the hadith, مَا ذِلْتُ أَعِيَا مَجَّةً مَجَّهَا فِي وَجْهِي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من دلو وأنا في الخامسة. I'm still remember a majja. Majja means that you fill your mouth with water and then throw it in the front of you, the other. He was playing with him, سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. So I still remember when Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم throws the water to his face from a bucket, from a well. He was playing with him. So also we have, who's else? Umayr. Umayr is the son, is the brother of Anas, the young brother. Umayr was about maybe three, كان فطيما, يعني just finished his breastfeeding, maybe 3 years old or something like that. Umayr has a bird. And this bird, he used to play with this bird. And then one day this bird died. And he was so sad, Umayr. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to him and he started to make him laugh by saying, Ya Umayr, ماذا فعل النغير? Nughayr means a small bird. And he started to laugh with him because he's very sad because the bird is died. This is the boys of the Sahaba. One example also we mentioned, Umar ibn Abi Salama. It will confuse now. The next one is Amr, not Umar. Amr ibn Salama, not Abu. So we have Umar and Amr. Umar, Abu Salama, is his mother Umm Salama, which is the wife of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Amr ibn Salama, different person. I'll tell you the story of Amr ibn Salama. Amr ibn Salama was about 6 years old or 7 years old when his father and his tribe went to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to accept Islam. And then when they returned back to their place, they tried to find someone who led the salah for them. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, فَلْيَأُمُّكُمْ أَقْرَأُكُمْ. The one with more Quran should lead the salah for you. And then when they start to find someone who memorized some of the surahs, how many surahs? No one, just fresh. They don't know anything about Islam, just accepted Islam. But they looked for Amr ibn Salama. He's a very small, smart boy, intelligent boy. He memorized a lot of surahs while he's still non-Muslim. How? His tribe was in the way on travel. So the Muslim during the travel used to sit in this tribe and then he learned it from the Muslims many surahs. And then they let him lead the salah for them because he is the most one who knows surahs. He was 6 to 7 years old. And one narration mentioned that while he's praying, he was wearing a jilbab short. So when he went to sujood, his awra, his private, exposed from the back. And then one lady in the back, because as you know, in the masjid, the lady will be in the back. There is no boundary between the male and female, but in the back. And then one lady, an old lady, said to the sahaba, cover the awra of your imam. Then they bought from him a long dress, and he said, this is the thing make me more happy after I became a Muslim, when they give him the long dress. So this is Amr ibn Salama, and this is Mas'ala. The scholar have opinions about the boy who can lead the salah for the adult. The opinions is that the boy can lead the salah for the adult in one case only, when there is no adult knowing how to read any surahs. Even this boy is a hafiz, but there is an adult who know a few surahs, the adult should lead the salah. It is not allowed for the boy to lead the salah. This is the opinion that I follow. I know some opinions said if he can understand the salah, the rules of salah, and he know more Quran, he can lead the salah. But this is minor opinion. The major opinion that only the adult, even they are less in Quran, they lead the salah. So this all the stories, we didn't start yet the hadith, by the way. This all the story shows how the young boys led the ummah, and we need that for these boys now. طيب, يا غلام, O young man, I shall teach you some of word of advice. Be mindful of Allah, and Allah will protect you. Be mindful of Allah, and Allah will find, you will find Him in front of you, supporting you. If you ask, ask Allah. If you seek help from Allah. And know, even all the ummah, all the people, all the nation, all the community were gathered together to benefit you with something, they would not benefit you except something rooted Allah wrote it for you. And even these people together gather to harm you something or to bring harm you with something, they will never do it except Allah wrote it against you. رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف means the pen has been lifted and the suhuf, the books has, the ink of the suhuf has been dried, means finished, the qadr is finished, the decree is finished. Another narration, I would cite the Tirmidhi, be mindful of Allah, you will find Him before you. Get to know Allah in the hardness, He will give you, He will know you in the easiness. And I'lam, know that if what have passed you by was not going to befall you, and that what has befallen you wasn't going to pass you. All this qadr. And know that the nasr, the victory, comes with a patient. If you want to have the victory, you have to be patient. And also relief with fitan, with affliction, and ease with hardship. Hikam, all this hikam. Let us start first by احفظ الله يحفظك. How can you be mindful, Allah Azza wa Jal, to get the protection of Allah Azza wa Jal? اعلم أخي الحبيب أن حفظ الله عز وجل, أن to be mindful of Allah means to observe and fulfill Allah's obligation. observe and fulfill his command, avoid his prohibitions, follow his rules. ومن حفظ الله عز وجل, one of the example of to be mindful is to not innovate something in his deen. Don't add in the deen something not belongs to the deen. الدين قد اكتمل. The deen has been completed. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. Today I completed your deen. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي. And fulfill my favor. ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. And I accepted Islam as your religion. So if you think that, if someone thinks that there is something missing in the deen and he discovered, he may be either jahil, ignorant, or maybe mubtada', one doing a bid'ah. So this is the how can you observe and fulfill Allah obligation so you will get the protection from Allah. وَعَلَمْ أَخِي الْحَبِيبِ أَنَّكَمَا قُلْتُ الدِّين قَدْ اكْتَمَلْ. As I said, the deen has been completed, as Allah said in Surah Al-Ma'idah. However, there is something maybe comes in your mind which seems to be an addition in the deen, but it is not bid'ah, not innovation. How can you recognize this thing, it is innovation or not innovation? I give you a very important golden rule. هناك نوعان من البدع. There are two types of بدع. كما قال الإمام الشاطبي في كتاب الاعتصام. As Imam الشاطبي mentioned in the book called الاعتصام. The بدع or the innovation are two types. The real بدعة, بدعة حقيقية, وبدعة إضافية, additional بدعة. What is the difference? I'll give you a very simple explanation. البدعة الحقيقية هي ما أي عمل خالف القرآن والسنة في ظاهره وباطنه وجميع أحواله. The bid'ah, the actual bid'ah or the real bid'ah, the real innovation is the innovation that opposite the Quran and Sunnah from external and internal. No one have a doubt about this. Clear, it's a bid'ah. And most of this bid'ah in the belief, in the aqa'id, that as we explain after the 300 Hijra years, which is the preferable time, the Salaf time, the Sahaba, the Tabi'een, the Tabi'it Tabi'een, when starts the 4th century and expansion of the Islamic state to and exposure to some of the culture like a Roman, like a Persian, like a, all this kind, a Greek, all that, and some of the science like a logic, like a philosophy has been affect the Islamic traditions. A new or a new sect has been came which deviated from the way of the Sahaba and the Tabi'at Tabi'in and produce a real bid'ah, because no one have doubt about that it is against what mentioned in the Quran and Hadith and according to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sahaba and Tabi'at Tabi'in. But the additional one is confusing. Al bid'ah al idafiyya. What is the additional one? Additional one, when you look to additional bid'ah from one side, it's okay, it's good. It is either doing dhikr or doing certain kind of ibadah or doing some action which is good. So why you said about that bid'ah? But if you look from another side, it maybe looks like a bid'ah. How can you control that? Very simple. Either كان الأمر ليس له أصل في الدين, سواء أصل ظاهر أو أصل يعني غير ظاهر, فهي بدعة. If the things has no source, no connection with the deen, either direct or indirect, it is a bid'ah. Like I give you an example. Taraweeh prayer. Very simple example. Taraweeh prayer in jama'ah, maybe someone argue and say it is a bid'ah. Because Umar ibn al-Khattab introduced while he was a khalifa, and he gathered the people on Ubay ibn Ka'b and they prayed together in jama'ah, and this wasn't common. But then hear the answer. It has an origin in the Sunnah. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam one night went in Ramadan, prayed in the masjid, and Sahaba joined him, and many lines start to join him. The next day, the same happened, and the number of the Sahaba increases. With the third day, the same. And then everyone in the city, in the Medina, start to talk about that Prophet start to pray Qiyamul Layli or Taraweeh together, Jama'ah. And then in the fourth night, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't go to pray Taraweeh. And the Sahaba waited for him till Fajr, but he didn't come to them. And then he explained to them after Fajr, I heard what you said last night, but if I go to pray, it will be compulsory for them. Imagine Taraweeh, if that happened, it will be compulsory for everyone to pray Taraweeh. So this is the origin of the Taraweeh in Jama'ah. He prayed four times or three times, but then he stopped. Then when Umar ibn Khattab came, he found everyone praying alone. What he did, he refresh again the original Sunnah. He didn't initiate something new. And some people say he said ni'mat al-bid'ah, what a good bid'ah. But he didn't mean the bid'ah in terms of religious bid'ah. This means that this was in his time something new, because the definition of bid'ah, something new, never exist before, especially in deen. So he said this is bid'ah in terms it has never happened in his time, but it has origin in the back. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now understand now, any change or anything that have a relation or have a connection with a Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even he did it once or twice, it is not a bid'ah. Type. For example,
He did it once, twice, three times.
Yes, and then he stopped. In jama'ah, yes. The same year, okay. 3 days in sequence.
No, in a different years.
He did only 1 year. 1 year for 3 days. And then he stopped because he worried it will be a compulsory.
So the fourth day he stopped?
He stopped, yes.
And the day after he
continued? No, he didn't continue at all. Just until Umar ibn Khattab came as a Khalifa and he nominated Ubay ibn Ka'b. No, it is not compulsory. Not compulsory. You lost, of course, you lost the reward if you didn't pray.
Yeah, but you performed a lot of like
yeah. Yes. Habibi, differentiate between it's the hukm, it's haram if you didn't pray, or the hukm, you will lose the reward if you didn't pray. So any sunnah, you will lose the reward, but you will not get sin. But you will lose the reward. Any sunnah, it is not compulsory. Yes, even any sunnah, you're not compulsory. Because the sunnah, definition of sunnah, it's a thing that if you do it, you will be rewarded. If you're not doing, you will not have sin. This is a ta'rif of sunnah min fiqh. طيب. So, in this point also, beard is different. Because Prophet Muhammad sallam in many ahadith mention أعفو اللحى أرخو اللحى أوفو اللحى. اللحى means that it is a command, a verb command, and for النهي يقتضي الوجوب أو يقتضي التحريم حسب الحكم. So when you have a command of Prophet, it means that it's either obligatory or prohibited. So he said أوفو اللحى, means make the liha or the beard long. And this is command. Any command from Prophet, it means it's compulsory, obligatory. Different, of course. Type. Now, we have another things. Something which seems to be additional bid'ah. We explain now the real bid'ah, al-bid'ah al-haqiqiyah, which is clearly opposite the Quran and Sunnah. Like the corrupted sect of Aqidah came in the 4th century and after. While the additional bid'ah, which already seems to be something have a relation with the Sunnah, but when you focus deeply in it, it is innovation. I give a very good example. Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Muhammad qala lahu, Wallahi, inni la'uhibbuka ya Mu'adh, inni nasihuka kalimat, an taj'ala dubara kulla salah, fataqul, اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. وكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يستغفر الله ثلاثا بعد الصلاة. So Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned to Mu'adh after every صلاة, say اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. And also one of the sunnah النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم after صلاة, أستغفر الله أستغفر الله Astaghfirullah. If someone, and this is not for the purposes of teaching, because sometimes in the school, when we want to teach the kids, after every salah, we repeat with them the azkar. This is just for learning purposes. But if someone, after he leads the salah, he start to say, Astaghfirullah, and the people start to repeat after him. Okay? What is the condition of that? It is that real bid'ah or additional bid'ah? Additional. Why additional? Because it is already has a source that Prophet Muhammad Sallam used to do that, but not in this way. Individual. So this is apply this like that. If Prophet Muhammad Sallam said to Sahaba to do something, and he didn't do it in a group, that means it has not to be in a group. Because if it's compulsory for the Sahaba to do adhkar after salah in a group, you will hear from many narrators that Prophet Muhammad Sallam did with that with them. Takbirat, he did it. This is practice of Prophet Muhammad Sallam. But I'm talking about after every salah. So this is the way that you know the difference between the real bid'ah and the additional. And posts are wrong. There is no bid'ah hasana and bid'ah sayyi'ah. There is no good bid'ah and bad bid'ah. Imam al-Shatibi mentioned we have only two types. A real bid'ah and additional bid'ah. And both of them dalal. Because Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, كل بدعة على كل محدثة بدعة وكل محدثة ضلال. Every innovation is a misguidance. This clear hadith. So no one can come after that and say we have good بدعة and bad بدعة. طيب احفظ الله يحفظ. One of the to be mindful with Allah Azza wa Jal is to do not innovate in the deen something new. احفظ الله كتجه تجاهك. You need to feel that Allah will support you if you fulfill His command, if you obey His command. وَعْلَمْ and know if the all nation together gather to get benefit for you, it will not happen unless Allah wrote it for you. And the opposite, if they together gather to harm you with something, Allah will not, you are not able to do that unless Allah wrote that against you. رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف, and the pen has been lifted and the sheet of recording has been dried. This is indication or indicate the qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal. عن عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن الله كتب المقادير مقادير الخلق قبل أن يخلق السماوات والأرض 50,000 سنة وكان عرشه على الماء. الله، حديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن عبد الله بن عمرو that Prophet محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم said Allah wrote the maqadir, the decree, the destiny of the all creation before he created the heaven and earth by 50,000 years and his arsh was above the water. This is the maqadir. والقدر أخي الحبيب عدة أنواع. There are different types of qadr. القدر الأزلي initial qadr which has been written in the لوح المحفوظ. This will never change. This has been written 50,000 years before the creation of heaven and earth. This قدر الأزلي. والقدر الميثاقي, the covenant قدر, when Allah Azza wa Jal brings all the creation of Adam from the back of Adam and took from them a covenant that way they will not worship someone except him. And he decreed that on them. But of course some of them misguided from that or misdeviate from that. This is the second qadr, qadr al-mithaqi. And also we have al-qadr al-umri, the life qadr. When the angel, Allah sent the angel, when the baby become 120 days and blow the spirit and then he will write his life and his rizq, he's a shaqi, he's sa'id, happy or sad or miserous. This is the qadr al-umr. Wa al-qadr al-hawli, the yearly qadr. What is the night? In this night, Allah descend the maqadir of the next year. Which night is? Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. Why laylatul qadr got this name? Because in this night, Allah descend the maqadir, the destiny of the next year. Who will die? Who will go to Hajj? And all of that in the lawhul mahfuz. And the last one, al-qadr al-yawmi, a daily qadr for every single day. Allah Azza wa Jal descend the maqadir of everyone. Yarfa'u aqwam wa yakhfudu aqwam. Elevate people and descend people. Yu'izz wa yuzil. So this is the level of qadr. You have to believe that. Don't think that someone has the ability to give you benefit without the wish of Allah. Without the will of Allah. Don't think that someone will harm you by himself. You have to believe in that. And look how this message, and some people said, we shouldn't talk with the young boys about such a complicated things, such about the qadr, the tawheed, the uluhiyya, rububiyya, asma, sifa. Prophet Muhammad sallam, look how he did. He said to Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he's a young boy, 7-8 years old. So you have to also learn, of course. طيب وأيضا تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة. So know Allah in the easiness or in the when you have a lot of thing, a lot of money, a lot of wealth in رخاء. What's called رخاء? Provisity. Sorry, what's called رخاء? Adversity, maybe. Type. And when you have the good condition of life, you have to know Allah to let Him know you when you have poverty. Type. Also, اعلم أن النصر مع الصبر. راء خاء ألف همزة. في الناس بتوع الإنجليزي whatever. Prosperity. So also you have to know that النصر مع الصبر, the victory with the patient. Last night we explained the hadith that the Jannah under the shade of the swords. وَالْجَنَّةَ تَحْتَ ذِلَالِ السِّيُوفِ. طيب, you have to know that. And also the easiness comes after hardness. This is when you have shiddah, you have hardness, remember that the easiness will come. All of this, يعني, if you want to summarize in one word, the qadr. You have to believe in the qadr. You have to believe that Allah Azza wa Jal, qadr, no one can against the qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal. You have to believe that every step, every action in this world is under the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. Ihsant. طيب, maybe someone ask, طيب, if that everything has been written and no one have a choice to change his qadr, so why we pray, why we fast, why we do such and such? By the way, this question is يعني is not a new question. The Sahaba themselves asked Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he explained to them, اعملوا فكلكم ميسر لما خلق له. So you don't know what has been written for you in the Lawh al-Mahfuz. So اعملوا, work. So everyone, Allah facilitate for him what has been written. So if Allah wrote for you that will be in the Jannah, Allah facilitate for you the way to be in Jannah. So you don't know. So you have to do. And this is a dar ikhtibar, a testing place. You have to do an ikhtibar or the test and don't say, I don't know if Allah knows the result, so why I do the test? No, this is not a Jabriya belief. This is the beauty of the Ahl Sunnah. They are a middle between what's called Jabriya and Qadriya. Jabriya said that Allah, يعني, jabr forced the people to do the action. And the Qadriya is opposite. Said that the people do the action without the will of Allah Azza wa Jalla, astaghfirullah. And the Ahl Sunnah in between, that Allah Jalla decreed everything for the people and give them the choice, give them the option, give them the mashi'a, but his mashi'a is controlling all of that. Alhamdulillah, yes, yes, yes. You don't know. طيب, this is so far, يعني, most of the lessons from the hadith, maybe a summarizing dot point to finish, inshallah. So first, the importance of teaching the kids, the deen, the importance of teaching them the qadr, the importance of, يعني, look after for them. And we give an example about the sahaba, huh? Who's still boys and young boys, Anas ibn Malik, Abdullah, Amr ibn Salama, who led the Salah while he's 6 or 7 years old, and Umar ibn Abi Salama, who is the son of the Abu Salama and Umm Salama, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the stepfather, and he teached him how to eat, and also Mahmud ibn Rabi'a. Who's Mahmud ibn Rabi'a? How was old of Mahmud Rabi'a when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam threw a water in his face? Was 5 years old. And also Umayr. Who's Umayr? Yes, and he's the son of Anas. So this looks how we should treat the new generation and the young with a rahma and the kindness. Also, one of the lessons of the hadith, if you be mindful of Allah by obeying his command, Allah will protect you in your deen and your dunya. And if someone break the hudud of Allah, he will not get this protection. Also, al-jaza'u min jins al-amal. So the reward is from this, comes from the amal. If you mindful Allah Azza wa Jal, so the jaza', the reward, that Allah protect you. Also, you have to think that Allah is only capable of help and support you. وَعْلَمْ أَخِرْ حَبِيبْ مَنْ لَجَأَ إِلَى بَشَرٍ فِي أَمْرٍ لَا يَقْدِرُ عَلَيْهِ إِلَّا الْخَالِقُ فَهَذَا شِرْكٌ. If you go to a one of the creation and ask it from him something that only Allah can do it, this is shirk. If you go to the doctor and you believe in the doctor, doctor, my son is sick, please cure him. and you believe that he has the ability to cure. Haram, shirk. Of course. Also, you have to believe in the qadr, in the destiny, and we explain the different level of qadr. And the qadr also, just to let you know, are 4 degree or 4 stages. Allah Azza wa Jalla wrote all the maqadir, how many years before he created the heaven and earth? 50,000 years. And where? In the lawhul mahfuz, the preserved tablet. After writing or al-kitaba, al-ilm. Allah know everything. You have to believe that Allah know everything. Al-kitaba wal-ilm wal-khalq. Allah Azza wa Jalla created everything. Wal-mashi'ah. And Allah have the will that controlling every will of each of us. This is the main principle of the qadr. Believe that Allah wrote everything of your life. Believe that Allah know everything of your life. Believe that Allah created everything in your life. Believe that the mashi'ah of Allah Azza wa Jal is over every mashi'ah in your life. If you do that, you'll be among the believer who believe in the 6 pillars of Iman. Because believing qadr is one of the pillars of Iman. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لكم. See you inshallah on Saturday night. Islam A to Z, purification of the soul section. جزاكم الله خيرا. Assalamu alaikum. Yeah.